want to connect with each other. And so, certainly, one of the most astonishing and bizarre events was in 1969, when the Woodstock gathering just exceeded all expectations and, you know, became overwhelmed with hundreds of thousands of people taking LSD at the same time. Now, that's never happened before in the world. And that, I say, is a religious event, you know, a kind of a benchmark in the disorganized religion of the psychedelics, where, you know, this notion of the discovery of LSD back in 43 is quite an amazing story in itself. The Boom Festival is another kind of echo of the rainbow, as is, you know, the Love Parade in Germany, and Boom, of course, is in Portugal. It's, you know, and, you know, the visionary artists are all over that festival, the Glastonbury Festival in England. You know, there's all over the planet there are festivals, the rainbow gatherings throughout the world, actually, and small gatherings of love writers. And there are communities that, you know, eventually ignite social change. And like the talk legalization movement has been something that has been an ongoing battle that all of us in the 60s thought, wow, that'll be over in a few years. So it continues, you know, this kind of aggressive desire to control our consciousness. And we have to argue for cognitive liberty in proper ways, like it's a civil right. And so change can happen, even for all of us, as has happened repeatedly, in especially in American culture, as a time when we really lose faith in the ideals, you know, of the, you know, that our government is apparently living on. You know, there are still opportunities for us to assemble together and discuss new ideas. You know, we have freedom of speech, and we should use it. And so
we need to articulate what it is that we want. I think one of the things we want is to regulate cannabis like alcohol.
David Best's amazing temples there at Burning Man, and Burning Man itself, the most visionary outcropping on the planet. Here, you know, we have a man who would hire people on the basis of how many LSD trips they had. His LSD experiences as on the top five experiences of his life. And so look where it got, you know, and all of us. And the understanding of fractal geometry and the Mandelball, all the various psychedelic gatherings that take place all over the planet. There's no other quote drugs that really inspires so much cultural activity. The mass has been continued warrior in this war on the people that is the war on drugs, and trying to find a sensible way with sitting down with reasonable people and wanting to really engage the mainstream in a discussion of how to integrate safely. And now we see the soldiers coming back. The main cause of death in the army is suicide. I mean, is that shameful or what? That's so shameful. We need medicine for people. We need soul medicine for shadow souls, and that's what this is. So we need to find ways of healing our shadow brothers and sisters. And that is part of the hope of what keeps mass going. And So join the mass, you know, and join reality sandwich. And so you get to see, you know, like the consciousness community finding ways of engaging in peaceful social action for consciousness change and transformation. The air-rated side is something I hope that anyone exploring those dimensions is familiar with, air-rated.
They have the database for all.
Yeah, every
all information
is out. All psychedelic substances on air-rated, and you know, field reports and things like that. The Moksha family. There's a number of places all over the world. This is down in Miami. They have a gallery that hosts many visionary cultural events. And Allyson and I have been on there for a lot. We have the Tribe 13 and Jen, who's put numerous shows throughout the world, extraordinary shows of great visionary artists, the California visionaries. The alchemized gatherings that have been occurring in Hawaii have run the visionary art worlds together. The Temple of Visions here in LA was really an extraordinary outcropping of the visionary
extremely dark, but it is
psychedelic and spiritual in the end. I mean, come on. This is this is a visionary film, and it has a visionary message that's important. And there are examples of visionary culture in the mainstream culture. And so our own lives have been finding these ways of getting the insights of the light body into our artwork and into the culture. And so my access to that was Padman through psychedelics. And so I always wanted to honor Dr. Hoffman. We got to meet him on his 100th birthday. This is the man that discovered LSD in 1943. And we'll get over to the rather miraculous discovery of it, but just to say that it was, I think, a bona fide miracle, because he said he heard the voice of LSD calling him to synthesize it. And I think of it as tears crying by a visionary reality, by the angels who wanted to connect with humanity, silly humanity that's about to blow themselves up.
And also, never having him before call him to synthesize it as he did else.
No.
Before ever.
No, never.
So was that the one who called?
Yeah. And he was not searching for any consciousness.
That's all he did, is synthesize people.
Yeah.
This one.
Dr. Hoffman was on the Nobel Prize giving committee. He was one of the respected members on that committee. And so at any rate, it was his fate to make this discovery. And so in Virginia, it was called St. Albert and the LSD Revolution. And so after he passed on just a couple of years ago, I was in conversation with his son, because my own
the age of 102.
Yeah, at 102 he passed on. But he was lucid up to the end. And so his son has given or long-term loaned the classes of Dr. Hoffman, the ones that he wore when he was synthesizing the molecule, and the ones that he wrote about in his bicycle ride back home. It was a Well, shall I read this?
If you missed it the other day, if you didn't miss it, it's worth hearing again. It's just astonishing. Close your eyes and listen.
Okay. This is
surreal.
The words of Dr. Albert Hoffman at the age of 101. He wrote this on Bicycle Day, 2007. Alienation from nature and the loss of the experience of being part of the living creation is the greatest tragedy of our materialistic era. It's the causative reason for ecological devastation and climate change. Therefore, I attribute absolute highest importance to consciousness change. I regard psychedelics as catalyzers for this. They're tools which are guiding our perception toward other deeper areas of our human existence, so that we again become aware of our spiritual essence. Psychedelic experiences in a safe setting can help our consciousness open up to the sensation of connection of being one with nature. LSD and related substances are not drugs in the usual sense, but are part of the sacred substances, which have been used for thousands of years in ritual settings. The classic psychedelics like LSD, psilocybin, and mescaline are characterized by the fact that they're neither toxic nor addictive. My great concern to separate psychedelics from the ongoing debates about drugs and to highlight the potential inherent of these substances for self-awareness as an adjunct in therapy, for fundamental research into the human mind. It's my wish that a modern analysis will emerge in which seeking humans can learn to have transcendent experiences with sacred substances in a safe setting. I'm convinced that these soul-opening, mind-revealing substances will find their appropriate place in our society and our culture. Dr. Albert. We have a little contact here with Dr. Larry Rombos, who we saw recently, and Ralph Metzner, and Houston Smith. Water Houston Clark Roy Griffiths, who did the Johns Hopkins study came and spoke at COSM back in 2008 with Rick Donald of NASA. Sasha Shulgin and Dan Shulgin were honored in this painting called The Shulgins and Their Chemical Angels. And here they kind of cradle the MDMA molecule. They did sign it at an event in at Mass Health. And so here's my cannabis goddess, Cannabia, and Cannabacus. Yeah, we love you. Jack McKenna and his stone monkey theory of the origin of language that elves told me, and Rick Strassman and his DMT, the spirit molecule. He owns this painting of DMT painting for him. This was my first DMT experience. It was a transfiguration. It was when I kind of lived it off and entered into this hyper monosphere. This was the first being that I saw on ayahuasca. My first ayahuasca trip was actually extremely beautiful. I got a really kind of, you know, I didn't really understand what it was because the first trip was so beautiful. I was really looking forward to the next time. That's how they get you. But this one really wanted me to see it. You know, it kind of came up real close. And it was just like a flow of jewels, you know, just like going down. And psyche, it woke kaleidoscopically interpenetrating and but flowing, you know, kind of like lighting up like a casino lighted, you know, or L wire or something, I don't know. So, and this was like a rare instance of doing a painting while on ayahuasca. But you can close your eyes and kind of check the colors, you know.
Because usually you those things when you're painting, just so people know.
Yeah.
You're not like tripping.
Or you buy it all the time, yeah.
Yes, but still, that's what you're
doing. Yeah, it's a matter of, you know, am I using substances or anything like that? No.
Yeah, but your paintings are generally recalled experiences.
Yeah.
Things that you notate in your journal.
Right. Like when I saw that angel, I went in real close to its feather, and I looked, this is like a microscopic view. It's a psychomicrograph, and imagine tiny area. Psychomicrography. This is a Franklin Paisley chair of feather chip. And this is angel skin. It's sort of like corpuscles in angel fractal skin. This is the ophanic eyelash. Or a little billy, you know, in the intestines of angels, digesting visions. So then the vision crystal, that is another fractal kind of angelic thing. This was the tail end of my transfiguration kind of DMT experience. This was a parting gift, you know, the image of this kind of thing that later got mapped onto the Rose Planetarium in New York at the it was really large and animated, so it was really fun. And then integrated the image into their stuff, and Adam invited me to work on their Lab Rouse album, and then he invited me to work on their music video bit. And then we started seeing this kind of stuff, you know, like, hey, City show. So interbeing, and then they used that in their stage shows. And the lighting just was incredibly killer at the 12 shows. And they introduced my work. I mean, you have a gallery show, you know, maybe a few hundred people show up. If you get a review, which is unlikely, but nevertheless, you try and maybe get a review. That's what it is by a few, thousand people maybe. You know, but you have your artwork as a backdrop of a tool show, and holy crap, and on their albums. And they're such consummate artists. They've been the greatest friends, to bring my work out there. Because, hey, Alex got any ideas for the stage, I guess I can see my painting. I was like, I've been working on this painting. Remember that idea I talked to you about 6 years ago or something? Anyway, it became a painting. And so on the 10,000 days, Adam is such a design genius. And he wanted to make this 3D element to it. So each, album is just this incredible work of art. And I worked with Meet Meyer to do this. And he's in Illinois. An amazing LA artist that was able to pull this off just computer graphically. The Bardo being, this is definitely influenced by tryptamines. The ayahuasca opened me up to the net of being, which was integrated into these tool shows and things. And this becomes a kind of shamanic initiatory experience for people to hear this music and then have images thrown at them, and there's continually assault with it. This is psychedelic culture, industrial strength, and it really hits people on a very deep level. And so I'm really honored to have been woven into their world. And so now I get to, wow, ouch, gee, what is, and just like people like showing me these things all the time. We get beautiful, amazing emails with folks.
Send us pictures, that's kind of the deal. You use Alex's art, we don't ask anything, we just say send us good pictures and we're allowed to reproduce them wherever we want. No questions asked.
The net being really kind of got around thanks to World Spirit. That's something that Allyson and I did to promote this idea of our unity together. Check it out. And then we started to have these kind of events, these live painting events, and it led to this whole element of love being portrayed on a kind of cosmic scale, and they're informed by the different festival stage settings and various things like that. And Allyson, I've been painting around the world at various festivals, and the Harmony Fest here, that was tried in Brazil. We started with a chapel in our apartment, really, for people who wanted to come and see the artwork. And then we were given a space in the New York City, and we built the first edition of the chapel of Sacred Mirrors. And so Ollie Burton and Shannon Fulcher, is that right, Gregory? A lot of artists joined together, Paul Kasafi, they joined together in creating this kind of sacred space for the community. And so the artwork was there, and we had a lot of events there. The sacred mirrors were all set up, and praying and kissing. And this was like a family room, and then the transcendental room, the theologue. You could, sit there and space out on it. And a lot of community events happened there, and it was this kind of mixture of spirituality and creativity and community. And extraordinary, characters would show up, like Stan Groff came and visited, Deepak, and a lot of folks from all over came, and they got some reviews, and events, for years. And so we knew that we wanted to move upstate and build an actual temple and to house these works of art that talk about these expanded states of awareness. And the idea came about for this temple. And it was a temple that was informed by the net of being painting. You can see that the beads that are all webbed together. And here you can see that when beings come together in oneness, they create sacred space in fractal kind of realization all the way down. And so with this vision, then we decided to finally find this place. And we found it just upstate New York, and it's about 65 miles up from Manhattan, very close, within walking distance of the Metro North New Hamburg train stop. This is a 40-acre site right here, and we impose this kind of idea of the goddess of the chapel, and the heart is right where the pulpit was. So we wanted to create a new gate. This is the angel gate. We got new doors coming. This is the doors for the chapel. Sacred geometry woven into beautifully carved by Wayne here in Bali. He's working on creating a better world. This is the other side of the doors. And so these are kind of our artistic selves that are creating this better world. This is one of the other stations on the land, our solar temple. We've been renovating there. We have to do the office. We have the land there, the guest house. When you come to stay with us at Cosmic or just visit, you might find yourself in the guest house. We've added a few visionary elements. And we have things like the Grail. If you want to support the growth of this kind of art as our religion, or the creativity as this new kind of spirituality, because it embraces all the different traditions, then you've got this Grail here. We have our full moon ceremonies where we gather together. Unbroken chain of us. We do a Mystic Artists Guild International, the Magi, workshops on visionary art. We have a lot of community events, drumming and dancing, fires. Pete Seeger came, bless the place, Julia Butterfly Hill. We have a bee operation there. We're making honey and whatever.
Bees to build a temple. We just got our second batch of honey, very above average bees. We have 85 new bottles, and they're actually still wasting.